Do you understand throughput? Okay. Now, do you know of OS block size of any operating system? Today, what is the most popular operating system that you have been working on? Linux. Okay. So, what's the OS block size on Linux? OS block sizes are usually smaller than the data. It has to be smaller than a database block size, because that's the relation, that a database block is composed of OS blocks, right? So from that you can guess that at least it has to be less than or equal to 8K, correct? Because you just mentioned that you have seen 8K database blocks in some of your databases. So Linux block size is 4K. Which means if you have an Oracle database on a Linux system, you can start from 4K beyond and beyond. You cannot be lower than 4K, which means the 2K limit will not apply on Linux systems. 2K is allowed by Oracle, but on OS, on that particular OS, it's not possible. So you will start with 4K on those systems. Now, when we say start with, what do you really mean? So now this question appears, that if you are aware that your application or whoever is going to be using this database is an OLTP type system, if it is going to do very small transactions, quick transactions, it should be utilizing some smaller block size. Understandable? So this is a very necessary database design time discussion, because most of the development teams would have to design databases from scratch, right? So do not accept an 8K database without knowing why are you doing it. Now, can you tell me, why have you seen 8K most of the times? Say that again. System is on Linux, but 8K is not, means 8K is not because you are on Linux. 8K has a different reason. That is one possibility. We'll come there in a minute. But okay, before I come to the answer, let's get another question. Why would you like a larger block size?
Data storage
also
there.
And
the smallest transaction is larger. Not as small as we can.
So something like you have a bucket and you want a bucket of water. So would you use spoon or any other utensils? Right? Or let's say you have a bucket of water and you have a transaction size or data size need for almost half a bucket. So then all of those utensils may not be useful. Maybe the largest of all of them is that what I mentioned is a curry preparation tool. So maybe two times use of that will fulfill your half bucket purpose, right? So that means a larger block size is required in what? Large transactions, large amount of data. Can that be a sub-second transaction? It is possible, but it's not necessary, because you now know, you know that the data is already large. You know that the transaction has a need of lot of data. So you are not expecting it to be fast. If it is fast, no problem. But if it is slow, you know that it is probably going to be slow. So these type of transactions, do not expect quick throughput. I'll give you another example and you'll be able to make more sense out of it. Think of a dictionary, a simple English, Kannada, any dictionary. If you want to find a word that starts with a B, let's say you want to find a word B-O-Y, boy. How quickly do you think you can find it?
We have a contents, meaning a marker there, a contents page or something like that, we directly go to the index.
If indexing page is there, then it's quite easy.
It's not an if. Dictionary, you know that dictionaries are sorted, right? So you know that dictionaries are sorted, which means indexing is understood, that it's there. So how long do you think you can find it? 10 seconds? 15 seconds? Find a page with B, next page with O, and you can go along, whatever word is it. So what did you just do with this? You found a single word, which means a very small transaction, single piece of data, and you used an index, one or more indexes on every letter of the words. So OLTP systems are expecting to use indexes because they need small amount of data, small amounts of data. If your need for data was larger, you may not use indexes. And I'll give you another example. Now you have to find all the words starting with a B from the dictionary. Now what will you do? And how much time will you take? So, see, when you say start with B and end before C, you are finding the range of the words that serves your initial piece of the work, that you have to find words starting with B. Now, but you have to find all the words starting with a B, which means now between those 10, 20, 30 pages, whatever, depending on the size of the dictionary, you have to go through every single page, every single word. You can sort what?
Our searching words, list of searching words.
You have to find every word that starts with a B. So there is nothing that you are leaving out. Every single word that starts with a B. It could be more than, say, 500 words starting with a B in a small dictionary also. So what I am trying to arrive at as, are you using an index anymore with this search? You cannot use an index. There is nothing that is indexed anymore for the current purpose. Only thing you will probably use the index is for finding the first page that starts with a B and the last page that ends in B, or you can say first page that starts with a C. So between these, you have to still go through every single word. So now there is no use of index. Large transaction. This is a large transaction. So what do you call this? What kind of transaction is this? Compared to our previous transaction, which was very small transaction, that was OLTP. Now what we just did? OLA, which is also referred to as data warehousing. Large data, large transactions, you do not expect many indexes. Or you can say indexes are not used. So then having them is a trouble for the database, because the database has to maintain them frequently. Is this understandable, or am I too fast? This is fine, because this is necessary to understand. When you start looking at queries, we have to know what is expected out of the query. And because you are developers, you are the ones who know what a query is expected to do. From a DBA standpoint, if the same concept has to be explained to a DBA, then DBA has to speak to developers first to find out what a query is doing and then give their inputs. But you are the ones who are creating the queries, right? So it's useful that you understand this first. Correct. So in OLTP systems, you will notice that to fulfill few queries, you may have created 5 different indexes, 10 different indexes on the same table. Now, can somebody tell me what is the purpose of a data warehouse? How does a data warehouse get built? Where is the data coming from? Exactly. So, data comes from an OLTP system into a data warehouse for what? This is the history of your OLTP system. So this is actual snapshot of some OLTP system, and now it is kept on the other side just as a history, which can be used for reporting, analytics, whatever you want to do. Purposes could be a lot, but the source is always an OLTP system for a data warehouse. And why are we talking about this? Because as you might already be aware, that on the OLTP side, you may have 10 or 15 indexes, 20 indexes on the same tables just to serve your OLTP queries, right? And because OLTP queries are very small, transactions are very small, so indexes are useful in getting whatever data you need, and that's it. OLTP should not grow in size too much. And from the previous event that we just saw, that all the data that becomes historical in OLTP systems should move to a data warehouse if it is required for historical purposes, which means OLTP will always remain small, because indexing is useful on smaller objects. As your objects grow, indexes become less and less useful. And that is why once your data moves into a data warehouse, you expect the least amount of indexes. So why am I mentioning this is because your original data that was on the OLTP system, here you had all the indexes which were required for the OLTP system, right? But now you are feeding the same data into your data warehouse. So the initial time, the first time when the data was copied on the data warehouse, sometimes people miss removing indexes which you do not need, because the indexes existed to serve OLTP. On the data warehouse side, what kind of indexes can you think of that you will definitely need? Yes, so you need only primary and foreign keys to maintain relationships between your data. And they were already there on the OLTP system also, those indexes were there. But any additional indexes that you have created to just serve your queries, not primary, not foreign key indexes, but other indexes, those need to be tested and dropped once you bring your data on the data warehouses. So this is one important thing to check if you already have some databases which you are working on. First find out, is it an OLTP type system or is it a data warehousing type system? What kind of transactions run on it? Many customers have mixed transactions going on, which is a problem, but that is what it is. We will deal with it during our discussions, how to deal with such data. But you should be finding out, you need to partition either the time of access, OLTP versus data warehouse, or the objects of access. So in this picture, you can see OLTP objects are completely separate database, and data warehouse data is completely separate. That's what we are hoping. That's the ideal scenario, that OLTP data flows into data warehousing somehow through ETL processes. This is why ETL processes exist. And when it reaches data warehouses, you need to find out unnecessary objects which are not needed. Usually they are indexes, and remove them. Now Oracle provides an interesting way of making indexes invisible first. So you can try making them invisible, test your application workloads on data warehousing side, and then drop them so that you don't have to drop them at the first time itself. You can make them invisible for testing. And we will work with that later also. But I am just giving you some ideas on how do you see these two things completely differently. These are completely different. If you are expecting to find all the words starting with a B, and you start using an index only, you force yourself to use the index, it will take time. Or if you wanted to search only for single word and you are not using an index, again you will take time. Yes, Vasudev.
Still we need to search from starting from A to till we find B, right?
So correct. Say that again.
Still we need to search starting from A till finding B.
Yes.
So there are many words in between.
Correct. And if you were not, you see, when you are looking for very specific word, are you using first example or the second one? You are trying to find out all the words with a B or single word?
I'm starting with B till ending.
Okay. So correct. So that is why we mentioned that primary key indexes are useful in data warehouse. So primary key will get you to the first letter of, first page of B and first page of C. And that is all you need with that index. You don't need other indexes. See, in OLTP, you have index on every single letter of the dictionary. That is why you are able to find a single word quickly. But for your larger transaction, you need just the first page and the first page of B and first page of C. That's it. Now, on every single letter, if you still have an index, but is that useful? Except for the first letter, you do not use the remaining letters for the index when you are finding all the words. But if you are finding a specific word, then you are using all the indexes. That is correct. Then first index will be used for the first letter. Now you find second letter. So second letter is also sorted. So that means now you are using the another index which is on second letters of every word of the dictionary. Right, so you are using indexes for your OLTP transactions, but not for data warehousing. Means, see, I am not saying data warehousing does not use any indexes at all. It has minimal use of indexes, that's all. So one or two indexes it will still use, but not too many. and because your source is OLTP, it is possible. This is a common error, or this is a common mistake that happens, that when we copy the table for the first time, all of the indexes also come with it, right? And we never care too much about removing them or dropping them, which is whatever is not used. Because Oracle has to spend CPU, spend its resources, spend memory on maintaining the indexes. So every time new data comes, Oracle has to maintain those indexes also in the background. So if you have unnecessary indexes, then your queries will suffer, your application will suffer. Right? So having this understanding will help you remember that on data warehouses, you don't need too many indexes. OLTP you can have, but still usability of indexes you should analyze it on both sides, whether it is data warehouse or OLTP. If an index exists, is it being used? So maybe some indexes are used every day, some indexes may be getting used every, say, week, depending on how your workload is distributed. But now, is this understandable? Okay, now can you tell me why 8K? We come back to the same question. Now that word is a little tricky. When you say optimal, that itself is a problem. It's just an average between data warehouse and OLTP. So Oracle has chosen that size so that it lies somewhere in the middle, which means if you don't know what kind of transactions will come on your database, and not knowing is actually not nice, but if you don't know, let's say your customer never told you, they just said create a database, now they disappeared, so now you have to create something. So that's why Oracle gave you that 8K, because it lies in the middle. So any kind of application, whether it is data warehouse or OLTP, will get an average performance with 8K, because it's in the middle. So it's not the best for any of them. Understandable? If you have the knowledge about your application or what kind of transactions will run on my database, you should be planning your block sizes at the time of the design of the database. And even if you do it later, it's not too late, as long as you are aware. Starting from Oracle 11z, Oracle allows you to have multiple block sizes within the same database. All right, so you can still have other block sizes later on as well. But having the knowledge is first and foremost, and then you start working on what objects are suitable for a certain block size, what objects are suitable for another block size. Right, so now, is this understandable? Why 8K? It's for the whole database. So if you see 8K, every single object in the whole database is stored on the disk using 8K block size. And that means if you have 8K block size, now we'll have to go a little deeper. Good question. Think of a row size in your average database. Because to calculate block size, a suitable block size, we have to consider row sizes, average and max, both. So let's say you have an employees table. So first field is name, then you have an ID, then you have a phone number, then you have address, salary. What else? Okay, this is enough for now. So name takes, say, 50 bytes. ID takes 10 bytes. I'm just talking about the length of the field. That is how you design tables, right? Phone, say 15 bytes. Address, 200 bytes. Salary, you would like it to be 10 bytes, but let's say it is 6 bytes. But the placeholder is still 10 bytes. Alright, so you hope sometime in the future it goes to 10 bytes. Okay, so now just add them up. 50, 10 makes 60, 75, 85, 285. 285 bytes is the max size of a single row in this table. Alright, now if you pick some data from this table and just calculate row length, you will realize that maybe average is coming around 250 or say 220. Because not everybody's name has their village and grandparents and everybody in their name. Plus addresses are sometimes short, sometimes large. So most of the times name and address are the columns which vary. Others are usually constant or similar to each other. Alright, so 250 is the average and 285 is the max. Now you will also analyze. See, we are talking about the design time, right? So either you can pick some sample data or you will have to imagine data. Because this is at the time of creation, unless you are working with an existing application where you already have some data, then you can analyze better. But now you have to find out how many rows have the max size. So let's say you have 1000 rows in the table, and just 10 of those 1000 rows have max size, the full 285 or close to 285 bytes utilized. All others are 220 to 250. Correct. So that means you would want to consider the larger number, the more popular number in the row size. All right. So we are coming with 250 in this example, because that is most, and just about 10 rows have max. Okay. So now tell me 250 bytes, which means 250 bytes of a single row. How many rows can fit in this block? If it is an 8K block, 250 bytes. So 4 rows means 1000 bytes and times 8. So about 32. So 32 is the max, but you want to leave some space. So we'll consider 28. Alright, so 28 rows will fit in an 8K block of this example. And I am considering, right now we are considering only one table, EMP table. You should be actually considering every table or every object that you know that will exist in your database, right? So 28 rows in an 8K block. Is that useful? We don't know yet. If it is a transactional application, if it is an OLTP application, you may want to go to explore a smaller block size. So now let's see, in a 4K block, how many of such rows can exist? Say half of that, so 14 rows. When you are doing a single row transaction, and when we say single row, it's not always a one row transaction. We mean to say that if the table has, say, a million rows or billion rows, you are looking for 5 rows, 10 rows. Think of IRCTC, Indian Railways Reservation System. That is the world's busiest OLTP system. And it is on Exadata. So we are lucky. That is why it works very well. Have you realized, have you seen, have you used IRCTC before 2010? And some of you might remember that the Tatkal times were really difficult. Things would just hang. Nothing would work. Searches would not work, or it would take too much time to come, and by that time the tickets are gone. So that used to happen. And right around that time, IRCTC moved to Exadata. And since that time, there is no time which is a problem on IRCTC. Right, but that is an appraise of Exadata. Okay, blocks are storing what? Yeah, that's a good introduction before you answer. But yes, blocks are storing what? Rows only.
Rows, indexes,
anything. Only rows, correct. So when you say tables, table is a larger entity, right? So we will come there later, but essentially blocks are storing rows.
Yeah. Rows.
Correct.
Will it store, can it store multiple from multiple tables, or a single block will store from only from one table?
So one table.
So one block, one table.
Hmm. But we will come to that. After this page, I will show you a relationship between blocks versus tables and many other different entities inside Oracle database, so that your understanding will become better. But essentially, a single block can have data from a single type of object. It could be a table, it could be an index, but table block will contain data for a table. Another table block can have data for another table, but not the same block. All right. So based on the row size calculation, you can always derive what kind of block size is suitable for my database, like we just did. So 14 rows can fit in a 4K block for this table, and 28 rows can fit in a 8K block. Now, depending. Correct.
So how to define that? I mean, once given 8K, that is for all the blocks. It's not like 8K for this table, or 10K for this table, or 16K like that.
Yes.
So when you design the
that
is why I was talking about that we have used just one table till now. Correct. So let's say you considered 20 tables in your database. For each of them, you calculated max and average row size, max and average row sizes, and you arrive at those numbers that in a 4K block, how many of those rows can fit? In a 8K block, how many of rows those rows can fit? Now, when you know these numbers, 14 and 28, or even for others, like 16K block can take 56 rows. Once you know these numbers, then you have to either, because you are designing the application, you would know yourself. If somebody else is asking you to create the application, you may need to discuss with them, maybe an architect or maybe somebody else, to find out that most of your transactions will be happy with 14 rows or a 28 rows or 56 rows. What's the minimum? What's the most frequent? If most of the times your queries, let's say you are doing a search on IRCTC for a particular date, particular combination of train stations, how many rows do you usually see between your common stations, say Bangalore, Chennai? You'll see about 20, 30 trains in a day, which means 20, 30 rows on the output. Correct? That is your number, most frequent. If 20, 30 is too much for most of the transactions. Let's say, because Bangalore Chennai is a very popular route, right? If I look for, say, Bangalore Delhi, there are just 4 trains. So then you will see just 4 rows. So now, whether Bangalore Delhi is more searched or Bangalore Chennai is more used, depending on that, you will come, you will have to prioritize these searches. That okay, we do not search for Bangalore Delhi very often, but we do search for Bangalore Chennai more often, which means about 20 rows, if they could fit in a single block, my queries would find it more useful. So then when we say about 20, 14 is also a very suitable number, 28 is also a suitable number. You will have to just decide between those two based on most of the queries. If they need lesser rows than 20, then use 14. If most of the queries use 20 or slightly higher number of rows, then use 28. Is this understandable? Depends on the use of that object. So even if that object, which has say 600 bytes of row size, if it is used as frequently as this object, then you will need to consider that also. Max row size and average row size of that object also. And for that object, let's say you come up with 10 rows in 16K, 5 rows in 8K, and 2 rows in 4K block for the larger table, for the larger row size table. Then again, same consideration for that table, that is, most of the times are you searching from that table? Are you expecting lesser number of rows, which is 2 to 5 rows, or you are expecting close to 10 rows? And based on that, decide the block size. But see, block size applies to the whole database initially. Later on, you have ways to create higher block sizes. You cannot have a lower block size, right? So you would, if you know that your application has OLTP, start with the lower block size first, and then you can have higher block sizes later with the help of a DBA. I'll show you how that happens. But starting with lower one leaves you the flexibility of the higher numbers. But if you chose 8K, you cannot go to 4K. If you chose 4K, you can go to all the other numbers. Right? So this is important to understand. So if that kind of table is there, a larger row size, then you will have to decide on a common number, or choose that object as a data warehousing object. Maybe that object is a data warehousing object, or which means it has too many rows, it has a lot of data, and it is usually searched not for few rows, but usually looked for a larger amount of scanning. So then you don't need to use 4K block size for that one. For that one, keep it marked in your tables. Initially create it with 4K, but then you can move it later. So see, what Oracle allows is, essentially block sizes exist at table space levels. And we will come to table space on the next page, when I'll show you the relationship between blocks, segments, tables, indexes, table spaces, everything. But essentially block sizes are considered at a table space level. So you can have a table space 4K, or you can say every table space is 4K because you are choosing 4K as the default block size initially. And every other larger object, you can have more table spaces created with the help of the DBA. Table space 8K, table space 16K, and put your tables in those table spaces to utilize that block size. If you just store your object in that table space, it will automatically utilize that table space's block size.
So
and it's a simple command. Alter table move table space and mention the new table space. So even if your older table was on a 4K or 8K block size, you can always move it to a higher block size table space.
So can we change the block size?
No, that is the problem. That is why you have this flexibility of other table spaces to which you can move your objects. You cannot change the default block size of the database. It is possible, but it's, see, technically it is possible, but it's not easy. And when I say easy, users will be affected. So you cannot access the database while a DBA is changing the block size. It is a big process. They just have to recreate the whole database. So essentially, it's not a very efficient thing. This tells me we might have a break time.